Thank you for those kind words of introduction and good afternoon, group. For those who don't know me, I've been a professional anti-death activist for the past 43 years. I've observed the successes and failures of countless anti-aging interventions, including paying to autopsy the bodies of supporters who die under questionable circumstances. And in almost every instance, the underlying cause of death was needless, which is why I'm opening up this presentation with a rather radical decree, and that is no one who's going to embark in an age reversal clinical trial is allowed to needlessly die. No exceptions, no needless deaths whatsoever. And by way of example, as it relates to needless deaths, are people who are seeking to live a long time, if not forever, but they ignore conventional cardiovascular risk factors like hypertension, lipid imbalances, coagulation disorders. They pretend like they don't have to worry about that because they're going to reverse their aging process. So these people are silently progressing to a point where it may not be possible to rescue them. In many cases, they're hanging by a thread, and they don't even know it sometimes because they didn't pay attention to the blood test results and their blood pressure monitor and instead ignored that until it was too late. No more needless deaths. That's why I opened up by saying we are determined to reverse aging and keep people alive as long as scientifically possible. Now, some good news about COVID, if you can call this anything in a way of good news. Well, COVID has instilled the reality, the harsh reality, that as people age, they become much more vulnerable to COVID mortality. Mortality risk skyrockets in COVID patients as they grow older, but so do heart disease risks. Heart attacks are virtually unknown in younger people, and as people age, their heart disease risk increases. Their stroke prevalence increases dramatically. The prevalence of dementia skyrockets as people age. COPD, the ability just to breathe, it's exponentially higher in older people, whereas younger people hardly ever have to deal with that issue. So when it relates to the risk of death, as we grow older, our risk increases every single year we're around. It skyrockets, and there's not really much difference between the skyrocketing incident of death in COVID and the skyrocketing incidences of death in aged individual. There's not really much of a difference. Aging puts us in a shooting gallery. We literally are ducks in a shooting gallery just waiting for one degenerative order or multiple ones to take us out. We gotta do something about that. So what I'm hoping with COVID is that it will instill scientific rationality in people as they grow older to do something about the aging process, circumvent it wherever you can, and don't continue to put your head in the sand and pretend I'm okay because I was COVID negative. You've got aging, unfortunately, attacking you left and right. Now, last year, we had an incredible event in Las Vegas. Over 1,000 people attended the RAADfest event. I'm going to try to update you a little bit in chronological order right now what has happened since last RAADfest. This is a wide-angle shot of the crowd in Las Vegas last year with me speaking. It was a very exciting, exhilarating event, and this is also exciting what's going on. Big money pouring into age reversal research. Just 3 days after RAADfest ended last year, a $25 million donation was made to the University of Miami to study stem cells, also studying stem cells in the way that it applies to age-related disorders. This is 3 days after RAADfest, and going back to year 2015, the media was talking about the FDA approving the first clinical study to see if a drug was metformin, could slow or reverse aging in elderly people. The problem with that study was there was no money, no funding whatsoever. It had FDA approval, but no money. And right before RAADfest last year, an anonymous donor wrote a $40 million check to make up for what the NIH already committed to put into it, and they've got $75 million of funding to launch a study to see if metformin by itself can slow and or reverse biological aging in elderly people. Tremendous, tremendous milestone. The problem is metformin by itself and we know this because our life extension group has been recommending metformin since 1995. Well, we know metformin by itself is great, but it's not the ultimate solution. This study, published October 15th, 2019, in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, they combined rapamycin, lithium, and a chemotherapy drug called tramitinib, and they were able to achieve a lifespan increase of 48% in fruit flies. And just so you understand, with a fruit fly experiment, if you increase lifespan 5 to 15%, that's considered really good. This one grabbed headline news around the world because they were able to increase the lifespan by an astounding 48%. Now, they also did individual studies with these fruit flies where they tried just one of these interventions, the lithium or the rapamycin or the tramitinib, and that boosted lifespan about 11%. Putting two of them together boosted it by 30%. But all three put together resulted in that astounding 48% lifespan increase in fruit flies. The emphasis is combination treatments are absolutely essential at this stage in order to keep ourselves alive to protect against degenerative aging. And this helps validate our stair-step approach to biological age control, which we've been showing at RAADfest over the last couple years. We can't do it with any one intervention. We need multiple interventions so that we live to year 2030, when gene therapies are likely to be developed and perfected that will enable us to grow younger again via a biological age reversal process that you're going to learn about in the next few minutes. This is beyond exciting, but we've got to make it to year 2030. Now, November 14th, 2019, big news. National Institute of Health made a $23 million grant to study rapamycin in people's pet dogs. A total of 10,000 dogs are in this study, and 500 will get rapamycin, and they're going to evaluate if rapamycin can extend healthy lifespan in people's pets. This is very, very good news, and congratulations, by the way, to these scientists. They've been pursuing this for many, many years, and they got this big grant from NIH, so we're really happy with that. Now, the media continues to report on the growing rebellion. That's what we call this, a revolution against aging and death conference, the growing rebellion against aging and death. And the fact that life's end is less final than what we originally thought. Really amazing. This is in the New Scientist, and scientific publications around the world are talking about the fact that aging is a reversible condition. Again, the National Institute of Health putting in $68 million to identify why certain families, they live to be around 100 years of age in relatively good health. So they're going to look at the genetic sequence, lifestyle factors, try to figure out what enables some people, some groups of people, to live a real long time so we can emulate that, so we can make it to at least age 100 when a lot more technology will be available. Now, December 8th, 2019, I spoke at an age reversal conference in Palm Beach County, Florida. There were some famous people there, Jesse Ventura, Newt Gingrich, and they were hearing people like myself and Liz Parrish and Bill Andrews talk about the science of age reversal. And there were about 325 people there, so it was a good event. I appreciated doing it, but less than a month later, Newt Gingrich, after hearing all of this science about enabling older people to grow younger, he wrote an article, appeared in Fox News, that hundreds of thousands of people read, that showed that aging is emerging as a reversible condition. Older people may not have to continue aging. So Newt Gingrich is an influencer, and by us influencing the influencers, we're getting hundreds of thousands of people to pay attention to what we're saying, and not just a few that happen to be sitting in an audience. Now, 2015, the Washington Post published an article about a Harvard geneticist named George Church. He predicted through gene therapy technology that he's working on that by year 2030, aging will become a relic of the past. And he's gotten some nice publicity in scientific publications because he is doing research that's unprecedented. He is enabling old types of cells to grow younger, all kind of good things to happen. But a study came out November 19th, 2019, 1.5 months after the RAADfest of 2019, George Church releases this study, published again in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. And he used a single dose of a combination gene therapy to induce improvements in heart function, endothelial function, kidney structure, and maybe most impressive at all, these were high-fat fed rats, and he was able to completely reverse obesity and type 2 diabetes in these rats that normally get very fat and very diabetic as they grow older. This is a single dose of a combination gene therapy. These are unprecedented findings, and they're continuing to occur. Now, I told you December 8th, I gave a talk in Palm Beach about age reversal, and it was a really nice crowd. I come home to watch 60 Minutes that night, and sure enough, they made the science that George Church is working on at Harvard, his genetic research, now pretty much a household word. They were able to depict him, and they did like a 25-minute segment showing what his laboratory is doing to eradicate all viruses and put aging in reverse. I'm going to play just a brief segment out of about a 20-minute segment that 60 Minutes had of George Church. This brief excerpt shows you that age reversal, it's going mainstream.
We have mapped the human genome, and in just the last few years, we have learned to read and write DNA like software.
One of the things your lab is working on is reversing aging.
That's right.
How is that possible?
Reversing aging is one of these things that is easy to dismiss, to say either we don't need it or it's impossible or both.
Oh, we need it.
Okay, we need it. That's good. We can agree on that. Well, aging reversal is something that's been proven about 8 different ways in animals where you can get, you know, faster reaction times or, you know, cognitive or repair of damaged tissues.
Proven 8 different ways? Why isn't this available?
What is available to mice?
So is this gene editing to achieve age reversal?
This is adding genes. So it's not really editing genes. It's the gene function is going down, and so we're boosting it back up by putting in extra copies of the genes.
What's the time horizon on age reversal in humans?
That's in clinical trials right now in dogs, and so that veterinary product might be a couple of years away, and then that takes another 10 years to get through the human clinical trial.
So how are we going to make it to year 2030 when gene therapies are going to potentially cure biological aging, put it in reverse? Well, the December 26, 2019 issue of the New England Journal of Medicine gave us a straightforward pathway to living a lot longer than what we ever expected. This is called intermittent fasting, also known as time-restricted eating. And in the animal model, well, if you restrict the time in which animals are eating down to about maybe 1/4 of the day, they wind up resolving virtually every degenerative process associated with premature aging and disease. They reverse that by restricting the time of the day in which the animals can eat. And in one study, they were able to improve lifespan up to 80% in a group of rats that was put on alternate day feeding. In humans, same thing. You restrict the time period in which people eat, keep it down to 6 to 8 hours on most days, and you reverse the underlying causes of diseases that are killing people today. This is the most effective way that we know of right now to extend your lifespan in a meaningful way so that you'll be around in year 2030 when George Church makes these incredible announcements about biological age reversal. Now, it may sound difficult to not eat more than 6 to 8 hours on most days, but let me tell you how I do it. It's really simple. I sleep 8 hours. I wake up, I'll drink a cup of green tea, black coffee, just something without any sugar or cream in it, of course. And what we do here, what I do is, here I am, 8 hours of sleep, plus about 10 hours of work. I'm not even hungry at this point. I'm so much into my work, I don't even think about food. So after about 18 hours, I think, well, maybe it's time to eat. Now, not everyone has to go 18 hours without eating. Somewhere between 14 and 18 on most days is all that people need. And in response to doing that, you basically resolve all of the common pathologies associated with modern man. The problems with vascular disease, malignancies, inflammation, abdominal fat mass, it all starts to dissipate. There's not a single prescription drug that can do all this. In fact, some people are on 6 or 7 prescription drugs trying to accomplish what intermittent fasting is able to do. And to put this in perspective at the cellular level, we know rapamycin has significant longevity effects in the animal models it's been tested in, but what rapamycin does is exactly what can be accomplished with intermittent fasting or time-restricted eating. Remarkable benefits at the cellular level and at every other level as it relates to our health and longevity. This is something you can look at when you review my PowerPoint slides. This is out of the New England Journal of Medicine. It describes all of the mechanistic abilities of time-restricted eating to improve health, reduce disease risk, make you feel better. It does pretty much everything you'd like to do if you could take a pill. Instead, just reduce the time frame of when you eat. So we talked about 2019 after RAADfest, and then January 2020, Happy New Year. It was really happy based on headline news that scientists from the Buck Institute, they did a study in the C. elegans model, and they were able to improve the lifespan, extend the lifespan, C. elegans, by about 500%. And what that equates to, as it relates to humans, is people living 400 to 500 years. This is unprecedented. That's why the media jumped all over it, because you have credentialed researchers doing a study where they modulated just two pathways and able to do it in a way to extend lifespan almost 500%. Those two pathways, by the way, are insulin signaling and mTOR. Well, that's why we take metformin. That's why people are taking rapamycin. And, of course, the time-restricted eating. You influence these pathways significantly if you engage in these types of activities. Now, none of that's going to work as well as what this study did, because what they did is they went in and they mutated the DAF2 gene and the mTOR pathway in a special way, in a way that they got these animals to live significantly longer. But can you imagine the human equivalent of 400 years? And the Buck Institute scientists talked about the fact, wow, we can translate that information into humans and at some point perhaps enable people to live that long with this one intervention. It's truly amazing. So January 2020, new magazine launched, Immortalist Magazine. It's put together by a longtime supporter, Ira Pastor. We compliment him on that. And, well, a book also released January 2020 called Immortality Incorporated. It got a very nice review in the Wall Street Journal. It's published by the National Geographic Society. You talk about going mainstream, by the way. And the book is about curing death, what the Silicon Valley billionaires are doing to find a way to defeat aging and live indefinitely. Immortality. It's going mainstream. Now, Dr. Michael Rose, he may be the most prominent and experienced researcher in the world as it relates to delaying aging in the animal model. Well, he's grown more optimistic in recent years, and he predicted in January that about 100 years from now, physicians will be able to keep people alive indefinitely. Wow, a mainstream scientist coming out and talking about indefinite lifespan in about 100 years. Bottom line, we don't have 100 years. We have to intervene now to reverse degenerative aging so we are not the last generation to die. Now, the good news continues to come out of the media. The CNBC reported how the billionaires in Silicon Valley, they're doing really well in every aspect of the world except, well, of course, they're aging. And they're putting big money into age reversal research. So by the time they get to be my age, I'm almost 66 years of age, by the way, they don't have to worry about all these pathologies and their very finite lifespan. They're looking to live forever. That's all tremendous news. Now, in March, a very interesting study came out in which they were able to take the blood cells of a 114-year-old woman and reprogram it back into an induced pluripotent stem cell. Now, the ramifications of this are huge. It got published in a major medical journal, and what they're looking at is the potential of taking old blood cells, regenerating them into hematopoietic stem cells and all kinds of other cells in the body that are youthful, and then clonally expanding these cells and putting them in large amounts and enabling old people to grow biologically younger in a major, major way. Now, these two pictures, these two graphics on the slide, the left hand shows the in vitro way of making this work, where you take out the old blood cells, reprogram them back to an induced pluripotent stem cell, hopefully a lot of hematopoietic stem cells that can both rejuvenate our immune system and produce lots of mesenchymal stem cells so that we can regenerate our aging body. Now, the one to the right is a simpler way of doing it, and that is programming a cell line that I'm going to show you next, programming that so that it induces transient tissue regeneration. And the importance of transient tissue regeneration for a frail old person is, well, you can't hit them too hard with an age reversal therapy. They may not be able to tolerate it. So what they're planning to do is use a cell line called Recyte 1 EC for endothelial cell, and they want to load it with telomerase, put it into older people, and those cells will release exosomes that will transiently improve telomere length, elongate telomeres, not too fast though. They want to do it in a slow way to basically naturally reverse aging by inducing transient tissue repair. And when I read this study, I didn't even realize that our Life Extension group had put up $2 million back in 2009 to develop this Recyte cell line that may be a way of reversing aging, reversing tissue damage. So I talked to Dr. Mike West about this technology, and I said, can you put this together in maybe a 4-paragraph email so that people who are going to review my slides online can read exactly how you plan to induce tissue regeneration through the Recyte cell line, releasing exosomes that elongates telomeres just enough to induce cellular regeneration without creating problems. So we go to April. Wall Street Journal runs an article about the fact that people born this generation, they're going to live to be 100 years of age or older. That's almost a given right now, that people born this century are going to live a real long time. However, most of us were born last century. That means we need to do something to catch up so that we are not the last generation to die of biological aging. And the good news is, a company called Alkahest, which we've been talking about since 2015, they take young plasma and they put it into old animals, mainly rodents, and they rejuvenate the brains of these rodents, and they've even rejuvenated other organs using young plasma transfer. Well, anyone who invested in this company did really well, a 318% increase in the value, but that's not my purpose of my talk here about how much money people made. It is the fact this company, Alkahest, has 6 phase 2 clinical trials going on right now to assess efficacy, mainly as it relates to using young plasma fractions to reverse neurodegenerative diseases. We're talking about Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and a huge number of problems that occur with the aging brain. So they're very well funded. Their Stanford University scientists are working around the clock to enable young plasma fractions, very specific ones, to reverse aging, and the money is there to make it happen. So the surrogate marker that we feel is most effective is one that measures epigenetic age. Epigenetics refers to changes in our gene expression that occur in response to how we behave. And if we want to accelerate our epigenetic age, which is bad, you don't want to accelerate aging, well, smoke cigarettes, eat overcooked food, and your epigenetic age profile, it goes up. And if you want to follow healthy lifestyles, like intermittent fasting, use something like rapamycin, you see epigenetic ages going in reverse. Now, they measure epigenetic age through DNA methylation patterns. Now, when you have poor DNA methylation, that's really bad because your beneficial genes are deactivated while harmful genes are overexpressed. So the principle of epigenetic aging is currently the most effective way of assessing in humans if an anti-aging regimen is really inducing significant age reversal. And the young plasma treatment more than cut in half the epigenetic age systemically of this group of rats, including cellular regeneration effects. They were also able to see cognitive improvement in addition to improved organ function, reduced cellular senescence. Absolutely spectacular. But going beyond just the blood tests and the organ improvements, look at grip strength. And how many of us nowadays try to open a jar and we find our hands don't seem to be as strong as they used to be? Well, grip strength is one of the validated ways of measuring human aging. And what they did with these old rats, they gave them this young plasma fraction, and within 10 days, they had the grip strength of young rats. It reversed that aspect of aging in just 10 days, this young plasma fraction. We can't wait to see how this technology advances to enable us to live longer. Now, a clinical trial is going on right now in the Bay Area where they're doing something that people term in lay language as the oil change theory, and that is you want to remove senile plasma, senile proteins from your plasma that are circumventing the ability to rejuvenate ourselves. So they did a study with animals like they've been doing, and they're verifying the fact that when you remove about 50% of the senile plasma proteins and just replace it with off-the-shelf albumin, you get a systemic rejuvenation effect. And the result is likely removal of all this extracellular junk that's circulating in our bloodstream, and we're not getting the benefits of an age reversal intervention because we've got something blocking it. So this study corroborates many other studies that removing senile proteins is a really good thing, and we look forward to the clinical trial results in people to see what kind of results are occurring. For those people who don't like to exercise, I've got some encouraging news for you. They did a study with rats that were old and sedentary, weren't able to do any kind of exercise, and of course they experienced accelerated brain aging. That happens when you don't exercise. Your risk of dementia increases and your cognitive facilities, they decline. So they took just middle-aged and old mice, put them into a cage with a treadmill, let them run on that treadmill for hours every day, and then they took the plasma out of those middle-aged and old mice and put it into the sedentary old mice, and they were able to see rejuvenation of the brains of mice who were not exercising. They were able to see new neurons being developed in the hippocampus, which is fantastic, but what's really fantastic is while we know exercise can help do that, these were sedentary mice, and all they got was the plasma from the active mice. And these were not young mice, these were mice middle-aged and older who were simply exercising. So for those of you who are using young plasma donors to try to reverse your aging process, it might be a good idea to find one who's very active, who exercises an hour or two every day, because you may get a much more powerful effect as it relates to your ability to grow new neurons and regenerate your brain if you get a healthy person who's physically active. So to surmise this study, the aged mice that received plasma from middle-aged or old mice that exercised, they got the beneficial effects in their brain without having to hit the treadmill. And even more exciting is an enzyme generated in the livers of the exercising mice was largely responsible for that brain-restoring effect. So again, for those people who hate to exercise and may not be able to afford a young plasma donor, there could be a pill someday. Just the enzyme that's released during exercise that regenerates your aged brain. Just absolutely fascinating research. Now, the November issue of Life Extension Magazine will have an exclusive interview with a scientist that is working on something called cardiosphere-derived cells. These are progenitor cells found in the heart. And what happened 3 years ago is I started talking about these cells because they're able to rejuvenate all parts of the heart and other parts of the body. They have systemic regenerative effects, and this looked like a potential to cure people who suffer from chronic heart failure. So we got real excited, but the company was not particularly responsive to my emails and phone calls, so I thought, well, maybe this research just didn't pan out, maybe they ran out of money. But I was pleasantly surprised that the research has continued, and what they're finding is that in response to these cardiosphere-derived cells, which are very easy to obtain from an old heart, an old human heart still has cardiosphere-derived cells, and they can remove them from an old heart, propagate them in a laboratory, and then systemically put them back in and induce gene expression improvements, elongate telomeres, restore cardiac function back to a more functional state. This is remarkable what they're working on. So we can't wait till this technology becomes available to muscular dystrophy patients, because we'll probably seek to study it in older people to see if we can reverse aging in people the way it did in the animal model. So we have all this science emerging that is inducing meaningful reversal of pathological aging processes in the fortunate rodents. Well, we need to gain access to that real fast because about 5,000 people a day are dying of degenerative aging. We need to bridge the longevity gap. We need to break through the delays, these barriers that are precluding consumers from accessing scientific advances that could very well save the lives of millions and millions of people. So here's one way we're going to do it. There is a charity called Better Humans. They've been around for 4 or 5 years. They've done incredible research, by the way, on NAD, senolytics, rapamycin. They've done so many proof of concept clinical studies that lets us know what's really happening in the field. But they have opened up the first anti-aging clinical trials facility that will seek to induce meaningful reversal of biological aging. They are located about an hour north of Orlando, Central Florida, and they are a charity. This is not a commercial company, but what's amazing is what they're going to do. This might look like a regular doctor's office to you. It's got some nice diagnostic equipment, but what they're doing is beyond comprehension. Of course, they're going to measure body composition when they introduce age reversal interventions. But what they have in this facility is a blood sample preparation room where they can draw blood from study subjects and then send it to their laboratory just a few miles away and get real-time sequencing as to how well an experimental age reversal therapy is really working, including the DNA methylation epigenetic aging clock. Wow, they can do that in a couple days as opposed to it taking a long time and costing a lot of money. They can do whole transcriptome gene expression testing. They have so many different ways of assessing aging. Now, this equipment would have cost tens or $20 million, huge amounts of money. This is a charity. I am a major contributor to it, as are about just three other people. We put in a couple million dollars to make this happen so we can do massive amounts of age reversal research on a consistent basis and get real-time results. Again, the Horvath clock for DNA methylation, that typically costs a lot of money. Well, that's going to be done on the premises. So if you're undergoing, let's say, a study where you're getting NAD and some senolytic treatments and rapamycin, they're going to be able to see real quick, is it working? If it's not working, we'll rearrange the dosing, add something, subtract something. They're going to be able to accelerate aging research beyond anything we've ever imagined, including evaluating whether or not the senolytic you're taking is really working by measuring the senescence-associated secretory phenotype. And of course, be able to get NAD measurements in real time to know if people are getting enough NAD restoration to repair their DNA. This is, again, unprecedented. And to even go a step further to let you know what they're doing, they're going to make their own stem cells and exosomes, mitochondria. They've got the CMP processing hood, that's hoods, and then they've got the sterile clean room where they can make biologicals, maintain cell lines, create induced pluripotent stem cells, reprogram cells, isolate mitochondrial for mitochondrial transfer research, isolate exosomes. They'll be able to make that on their premises, not have to pay these outlandish commercial prices, and then test different combinations of all these therapies in humans. And just so you know, Better Humans has conducted 6 clinical trials in which they've enabled us to understand that NAD restoration and senolytic therapy and a number of other interventions, they do have real-world benefits. They're now going to be able to combine all of these different interventions and then measure in real time whether or not people are growing biologically younger. So this organization, which again is a charity, they do not charge people to participate in their studies. So if you happen to live around your Orlando area and you want to participate in some of these studies, well, just log on to the Better Humans website, just send them an email, and you'll get put on the list, and then they'll reach out to you when they said when they're ready to do a clinical study. It's very, very impressive. Now, senolytics. We've got a big update coming up for you here about senolytics. Now, most of you understand that senescent cells accumulate with age. They impede organ function, they create systemic inflammation, and then they emit these protein-degrading enzymes that destroy surrounding cells. We've seen the results from clinical trials and in the animal model. And that's what's most impressive. These animal model studies use very high doses and are able to show systemic age reversal in response to dasatinib and quercetin. Just those two senolytics together have induced major, major regenerative effects by getting rid of the senescent cell burden that older people suffer. Now, Dr. Alan Green practices up in Little Neck, New York, and he's a real hero in a lot of ways because he takes the information that many of you understand and he puts it into clinical practice. For many years, he's been prescribing rapamycin and metformin and other AMPK activators to his patients. He's got 500 who have undergone rapamycin treatment. He reports very good results on his website. And what he did recently is he started adding a senolytic protocol to the people already taking rapamycin. And this is a very, very aggressive senolytic protocol. And that involves the dasatinib, 100 milligrams a day for 3 days, quercetin for 3 days, and then fisetin, 1,500 milligrams for 3 days. And he's doing that 4 times a year for healthy people. And for people with degenerative illnesses, he's doing it 1 or 2 times a month. He's reporting to us good results. You can read everything about what he's doing on the website on this slide. Now, I'm not advocating that anybody follow that particular protocol right now on your own, because it is very aggressive, much more aggressive than anything we've ever recommended before. But the good news with the Better Humans Research Facility is we can test Dr. Green's protocol and see just how well it is reducing the senescent cell burden, and then be able to advise our support groups, our various age reversal networks, RAADfest attendees, what's really working, what is that ideal dose to induce age reversal without overdoing it. So the good news is that we can remove senescent cells from aging bodies. The bad news is, based on a publication of December 2019, is the senescent cell problem is worse than what we thought. We know these production of senescent cells increases with age. We know they catalyze their own production. And trying to remove them becomes more difficult with aging, mainly because our immune function, it declines. And immune function is a powerful way that we normally reduce our senescent cell burden. So senescent cells, they accumulate to the point where they reduce our ability to remove them in the body. It's literally a snowball effect. And some research that they published again in December 2019, it showed that in a young mouse, they're able to remove senescent cells in about 5 days. They have a very fast turnover, but the older mouse takes 25 days. And a problem with that is the burden of increasing senescent cells overcomes the ability to remove them, and you eventually die from an excess amount of senescent cells. In this study, when 30% of the cells became senescent, that was pretty much the tipping point that led people to death. So we can't wait to see how various senolytic compounds reduces senescent cell burden. Now, a new study that our Life Extension Group funded sought to identify a way to make fisetin, which may be the most effective senolytic agent out there. A lot of people have speculated about that, but we've been able to make it available in a form that absorbs from the small intestines into the bloodstream. And we've been getting calls from people, frankly, for the last 3-4 years saying, why aren't you selling high-dose fisetin? And our response is, well, we're not sure you absorb any of it. And if you do absorb some of it, it's very inconsistent. This biofisetin was shown to have 25 times greater absorption. And the great news is it costs about $11 a month. It's very inexpensive. So we're going to advocate for some people to supplement with fisetin every day. Instead of doing an aggressive senolytic protocol 4 times a year, let's see what happens when you use a senolytic every single day to emulate what occurs in nature. A young person's immune system is constantly removing senescent cells, and when we grow older, we lose that ability. So what the researchers have done up to now is put people on high doses of dasatinib and quercetin and fisetin and hope they're going to get rid of enough senescent cells to make a difference. Maybe more effective just to take one fisetin capsule a day, very inexpensive, and see if that doesn't work better. This is a major advance. It's available right now at Life Extension. I'm bringing it up because up until now, there's been no reliable way to utilize fisetin in a way that it systemically gets in the body and removes senescent cells. Well, we did a survey last couple months with our Age Reversal Network to see what was going on out there. We got over 5,000 members, and over 500 of them responded. And the good news is they are following the suggestions that have been made at various RAADfest events. Most of them are using some form of NAD replenishment, senolytics. 61% are engaging in fasting. Congratulations, group. Congratulations for being ahead of the curve. And the benefits with NAD of any form was improved energy levels and improved sense of well-being. And those are okay. This is adding on the NAD to everything else that they were doing. So those are pretty good numbers, but nothing compared to fasting. The benefits of fasting, a 54% improvement in your sense of well-being, 47% increase in your energy levels, wow, 44% reduction in body fat. These are far greater benefits than what you're going to see with virtually anything else. But then again, when it came to hormone replacement therapy, as it relates to feeling better, wow, you're going to 74% people had an improved sense of well-being, greater energy levels, improved cognitive function, reduction of excess body fat. It turns out that the winner of our survey was technology that we evolved back in the 1980s, and that is replace your hormones that are lost to aging. And when you do that, you get a better anti-aging effect that you can feel than with any other therapy. So we tend to forget what was working in the past because new technologies evolve and people get all excited about NAD and senolytics and rapamycin and everything else that's come about over the last 5 years, including young plasma, but we forget about our hormones. So please, when you get your blood tested and you're hormone deficient, well, restore those hormones back to a youthful range and you're gonna probably feel a heck of a lot better. So the dilemma that we're faced with today is a lot of people are out there on their own experimenting without really informing a group of people what they're doing. So we're losing a lot of data in that regard. But we know that there's no single therapy that's going to address all of the pathological processes involved with degenerative aging. Not a single therapy is going to work. So the solution is to intervene with a cocktail, a combination of treatments that has been shown in various models to improve healthy longevity and measure the biological age, also the clinical measures of aging. If you're able to get people off their blood pressure medication, get them off their statin drugs in response to what you're doing, you've accomplished something really meaningful. But we also want to look at that DNA methylation pattern clock and see if we can't reverse epigenetic age. And that's what we plan to do. So this is our current strategy to reverse aging in people today. It involves many, many different interventions. And the bottom line is they've all been shown to work individually in various models of research. We want to put them all together. So clinical trials update. Vitality and Aging, a nonprofit group. It has two clinical trials going, the interventions trial and the longitudinal study. The interventions trial is fully funded, which is fantastic news. It will enroll 50 people in an attempt to reverse their aging process over a 12 to 15 month period. Now, for those who aren't qualified for the interventions trial, we have the longitudinal study where you can get the same types of diagnostic tests and interventions at subsidized prices, by the way, and it's available to everyone. So everyone can engage in a systematic age reversal research project, whether they're chosen for the interventions trial or choose to join the longitudinal study. Now, the goal of the interventions trial is to induce statistically significant, I really want to emphasize this word, statistically significant and real world age reversal in a period of 12 to 15 months. And the objective with the research is to combine the compounds that either individually or in other ways have been shown to improve health span and lifespan in model organisms. Now, this is fully funded, and that's very important, by the way, because there's a lot of clinical trials out there that you can read about on clinicaltrials.gov, and they look fantastic. Trouble is, some of them have zero funding, like the metformin study in 2015. Nobody thought that trial would ever get funded, and the delay in funding it, well, here we are in 2020, and they're just getting that trial started. This trial has full funding, and we're allocating about $20,000 of subsidized prices per study subject, which might equal $40,000 in the real world. So our objective is to put the pieces of the puzzle together, utilizing all of these age reversal interventions that are working in all kinds of model organisms, put them together in a way that we reverse aging in this group of people. Now, to fund this project, this interventions trial. I set up a charity called the Human Age Reversal Project last year. The objective was to raise about $530,000. Well, we received over $900,000 in donation, which means we are fully funded. The donations received will enable us to do 12 to 15 or more months of research on these study subjects. And even better news, I've had some pledges, and these are really substantial pledges. They haven't let me down yet, another $100,000. So we're going to be up over $1 million in January to launch the Vitality in Aging Interventions Trial. And up until now, by the way, I funded everything out of my own pocket. 100% has come out of my pocket, and therefore, all the money you're seeing there is in the bank, ready to go, ready to launch this clinical study. It means a lot. For those who don't qualify for the interventions trial, and we only have 50 slots open for that particular study, you can join the Vitality in Aging Longitudinal Study, where you get virtually all the same benefits, except you'd have to pay for them out of pocket. And the objective of the study is to identify risk factors causing you to age, access biomarker tests at subsidized pricing, access the therapeutic interventions at subsidized pricing, and then test the efficacy of what's going on so we know what's working. Essentially, join a team effort to defeat aging. Now, to enroll in the longitudinal study requires $495. That's an annual fee at a minimum to do the age management blood test panel. We recommend this be done at least once a year. And then we use the test results from the age management panel to adjust your longevity program. And then we're going to retest, which you'll have to pay for, by the way, those markers that are out of balance to see if we weren't able to improve the way you are aging today, to reverse risk factors that are causing people to die prematurely. And the idea of being able to adjust interventions based on your retest results are unprecedented. This is modeled after Framingham, by the way, the study that, well, has enabled us to understand that hypertension and lipid imbalance and a whole lot of other risk factors, they cause heart disease. Now, the commercial price of the age management test panel, $3,000. A lot of money because there's a lot of tests. The subsidized vitality and aging price, $495. The vitalityandaging.org is where you enroll into this study. And just to update people, many of you last year paid $595 for the age management panel that included other tests. We weren't able to do those other tests. So everyone who paid $595 last year has a $200 credit, and then that can be applied to your second age management panel, which I hope you'll do this month because it's been 1 year since we did most of these panels back at RAADfest in Las Vegas. And because of the $200 credit, your price is only $295 this year for the age management blood test panel. I'm going to review what's included in this panel so you realize what an incredible value it is. Cardiac and inflammatory blood markers. Conventional medicine looks at what's on the left, and we look at that too. Total cholesterol, LDL, triglycerides. We want to know what that is, but then we add to it interleukin-6, apolipoprotein B, small dense LDL, particle size of LDL, C-reactive protein, homocysteine. We don't want any more people needlessly dying of a stroke, a heart attack. So we're looking at every marker we can afford to identify individual risk factors that are correctable so that you don't leave us prematurely. We want to make sure that nothing is out of balance as it relates to your fatty acid profile. And the objective of optimizing your fatty acid profile is to reduce your risk of chronic inflammation, malignancies, and of course, cardiovascular disease. Assuring an optimal fatty acid profile is one of the better ways to accomplish that. And of course, we want to look at glycemic markers, including fasting insulin, because some people, they have low glucose, low A1C, and the reason is they're excessively producing insulin, which we view when produced in excess as a death hormone. So we want to make sure that your glycemic control is in place as you go through these various age reversal interventions. We don't want to overlook the obvious. And of course, hormones, as we mentioned, you want to feel better, you want to lose weight. Well, hormones are the most effective way to do it based on our survey results. So we look at all the hormones related to aging and how you can replace them so easily and say, let's get those numbers so you know what you need to do to optimize your hormone balance. And of course, we're going to look at liver and kidney function. Hopefully, we improve it as we engage with all these age reversal interventions, but we also don't want to worsen it. So we're going to pay attention to your kidney and liver function to make sure that you're getting the benefits you're looking for and not getting any detrimental problems. Mineral electrolyte balance. If you are imbalanced with electrolytes, your risk of sudden cardiac arrest, very, very high. We don't want any sudden heart attacks taking out our supporters. Blood oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, very, very important. Older people often have anemia. It's not really treated. We're going to make sure no one has low blood oxygen carrying capacity, circulating immune cell counts, and of course for men, PSA. Any man with prostate cancer, we want that cancer treated. There are effective ways to do it nowadays that don't involve surgery or radiation, and we want men to be able to take advantage of that number to know if they need to be looked at closer. So the number one killer still is heart attack and stroke. It's killing people who have attended RAADfest before, and a lot of that had to do with people, frankly, not paying attention to their vascular risk factors. This slide shows about 20 independent risk factors that cause heart attacks and strokes. If there's any one of them out of balance, you want to correct that. That's the purpose of the age management panel. We don't want people prematurely dying on this. We don't want to see any more needless deaths. So we put together this panel, commercial price, about $3,000. You get it for $495 by participating in the Vitality and Aging Study. So the biggest enemy, our biggest enemy, procrastination. It has killed a number of RAADfest alumni where they knew they should have engaged in an age reversal intervention, where they knew they had some blood markers that were out of balance, and they just decided they didn't need to do anything about it. And that's a real shame, because even the wealthiest people in the world are not getting the best medical attention that they should. I show these every year. The dead billionaires who could have bought themselves a lot of extra life if they had maybe joined a group of people who were determined to never die, maybe they would have lived a heck of a lot longer with the kind of money they had. And they were very generous. All these people wrote big checks to charities, but they didn't focus on aging. And aging is what kills people. This individual had a net worth of over $4 billion. He died of COVID, but he probably really didn't. I think he died of aging. He was age 78. He got the SARS-CoV-2 virus, and it killed him. At the age of 48, it may have just been a week or two sick, or maybe he never would have felt it. So aging is the number one problem that we need to reverse. This is the charity that's funding the Vitality and Aging Interventions Trial. It's got over $900,000 in the bank. Nothing has been spent. We thank the donors who put the money into it. We've got more money coming in. And if you feel like adding this to your list of charities, I suggest you do, because the more money we take in, the more research we can fund. We can extend the study from 12 to 15 months to maybe 20 to 30 months. Now, I've talked about the money, many millions of dollars I've spent out of my own pocket. I get the money from the dietary supplements I sell. So if you're interested in supporting aging research and you can't afford to make donations, well, if you buy our supplements, you are indirectly supporting rejuvenation projects. I want to thank everyone for their support of life extension. This has been 43 consecutive years that we have sought to find ways to mitigate the toxicity, and it really is toxicity, of biological aging. And for those who want to review the entire slide presentation I've made, age-reversal.net, the whole presentation is on there right now for your review. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you so much.